Okay, let's dive right in. We're going to tackle a concept straight from Michael Rava's microeconomics lectures in Jerusalem, and it's something that honestly trips up so many students. We're talking about the demand curve, and it all comes down to one single, really simple question.
And this question, I mean, it gets right to the heart of the confusion, doesn't it? You know how it is. You see the price of something go up, and of course, you buy less of it. So your gut tells you, hey, the price changed my demand. But, and this is the key part, in the world of economics, that's not exactly what's going on. So let's unpack this whole thing.
All right, the entire solution here, the whole thing, it really hinges on one single crucial distinction. Are we just moving along a demand curve that's already there, or is the entire curve itself actually shifting? I promise you, getting this right is the absolute key to understanding everything else we're going to talk about.
So here's the number one rule you have to remember. If the price of the product itself changes, you're just moving on the curve. That changes the quantity you want to buy right now. But if some external factor changes, something completely outside the product's price tag, that causes a movement of the entire curve. And that means your fundamental desire for that product at any price has changed.
Okay, think of it this way. Let's say your favorite cheese gets more expensive. You might go from buying two packages a week down to just one. See, you've just moved to a different spot on your existing demand curve, a lower quantity because of a higher price. But your overall love for that cheese, that hasn't changed. The curve itself hasn't budged an inch.
So, if a price change doesn't shift the curve, then the obvious next question is, well, what does? What are these mysterious external factors that are powerful enough to completely redraw the demand line for something?
Well, here are the main culprits. A big one is a change in your income. You know, for most things, what we call normal goods, if you get a raise, you buy more of them, and your whole demand curve shifts to the right. The opposite is true for what we call inferior goods. But let's really zero in on that last point, because it's a great example, substitute products.
Yeah, think about tea and coffee. They're the classic example of substitutes. If tea suddenly gets way, way cheaper, a bunch of people are going to start buying more tea instead of coffee. They're still getting that caffeine they need, right? So their overall demand for coffee just drops. And here's the punchline. The price of coffee didn't change at all, but the demand for it went down. That is a shift of the entire curve to the left.
Okay, so we've seen how things like your income or the price of other goods can shift demand. But what happens when a really powerful external player enters the game? Like, say, the government. Let's take a look at what happens when something like a new tax is introduced into a market.
Now, this is where it gets really interesting. You might think a tax is an external factor that changes demand, but it's not. A tax on a product is really an added cost for the producer. It suddenly becomes more expensive for companies to make and sell that item. So a tax doesn't move the demand curve one bit. Instead, it directly hits the supply curve, pushing it up and to the left.
All right, let's make this real. We're going to use the air conditioner market as a case study to see exactly how a new tax can ripple through the whole system.
Okay, first things first, let's set the stage. Before any government intervention, before any tax, the market is in what we call equilibrium. Buyers and sellers have naturally agreed on a price of 6,000 shekels for an air conditioner. That's our baseline.
And now the government steps in. It slaps a 1,000 shekel tax on every single air conditioner sold. This one move instantly changes the entire cost structure for the producers, and believe me, it sets off a really powerful chain reaction.
So what happens? Well, there's a clear sequence of events. First, that supply curve shifts to the left because of the new cost. This new supply curve now crosses our original demand curve at a totally new, higher price. And what's the result of all that? It's simple. Fewer air conditioners get sold, consumers end up paying more, and the producers, well, they ultimately get to keep less money.
And this part is so important. The burden of that tax is almost always shared. The price for the consumer doesn't just jump up by the full 1,000 shekels. No way. Instead, the new price lands somewhere in the middle. The consumer pays a little more than before, and the producer gets to pocket a little less. Both sides end up absorbing part of that cost.
Ultimately, what a tax does is it drives this wedge right between the price the buyer pays and the price the seller actually receives. The whole market shrinks. And, just as the lecturer puts it, both the consumer and the producer are hurt by this.
But wait a minute. Is that burden always shared 50-50? Not at all. To figure out who actually gets hit harder by a tax, we have to bring in one last really powerful idea, elasticity.
So what in the world is elastic demand? The easiest way to think about it is just price sensitivity. If a product has really elastic demand, it just means that consumers are super, super responsive to price changes.
If the price goes up even a little bit, people stop buying it in huge numbers. And when you draw it out, this looks like a much flatter demand curve.
And this leads to a really critical consequence. If the government taxes a product that has super elastic demand, you know, something people can easily find a substitute for or just live without, the market for that product can shrink dramatically. Faced with that higher price, consumers just walk away and sales completely plummet.
Which brings us to our final big question. If demand is really sensitive to price, if it's elastic, who do you think ends up paying more of that tax? Is it the consumer who can just easily stop buying the product? Or is it the producer who's now stuck trying to sell that same product at a new, higher price that nobody wants to pay? The answer is right there in the shape of the curve.